Hey, this is Lee Nevis, host of See Jane Sell. Thanks for listening to the following podcast on Public House Media.
Throughout history, the course of sports has been shaped by one thing, the fans.
From the moments you never dreamed of...
the moments that still give you nightmares.
Behind the back, it gets through Buckner. Here comes Knight, and the Mets win it.
He's in! Patriots win the Super Bowl! Brady has his fifth!
Through the good and the bad, fans have helped change the games we watch and the players we love.
They may not be the most logical people.
You are a factory of sadness!
I'll see you Sunday.
But they know their teams better than anybody.
They'll blow it the ninth.
You may not always see them, but you know where to find them.
After all, there's nothing quite like the view from the cheap seats.
Broadcasting as part of the Public House Media Network.
Grab a chair and enjoy all there is in
the cheap seats.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, welcome back once again up into the cheap seats. Getting a little bit cold out here on the East Coast, Midwest area. So, John, it's weird, just as I go into the intro here and I stumble upon my own thoughts. You're in New York. I am
yes.
In Western Pennsylvania. I'm in Pittsburgh, right?
Right.
Do you think of... the state of Pennsylvania and Western Pennsylvania specifically as an East Coast or as a Midwest state or somewhere in between?
I would say Western Pennsylvania I would consider, you know, more central, you know, not the East Coast. I mean, I'm in northern New Jersey, you know, 45 minutes outside of New York. And obviously, you know, it's the Northeast. But I think for you – out there in Western PA, that's not East in any way for me.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, see, when I think of Northern New Jersey, when I think of New York State, New York City, of course, that's about as East as it gets. But see, I grew up in Northwest Ohio, which is
right.
Absolutely the Midwest. I feel like Cleveland is the start of the Midwest. So
yes,
that's where
I think that's fair.
Where. Yeah, that's where I draw the line, and we're just a little bit east of that by about 200 miles. So, I don't know. I think the official term is Mid-Atlantic, which is why
yeah.
Pitt gets away with playing in the Atlantic Coast Conference, and every other team is in North Carolina, and it's dumb, and it just doesn't fit at all.
Yeah, well, then there's Syracuse as well, so that's also dumb.
Exactly. I mean, I think we've talked about it on previous shows. The demise of the Big East was just terrible for just common sense, I think, in all of sports. And if anything is to be said as a break from common sense in sports, it's the Cheap Seats podcast brought to you by Public House Media. He's John Lauder. I'm Josh Powers. And we've already kind of gotten a little bit underway with some of the madness we're going to discuss on today's show. There's a lot in sports that kind of makes us crazy. And I think as it comes toward the end of baseball season and toward the beginning of basketball season and hockey season, and here toward the middle of football season, you know, the sports nexus or the sports equinox is upon us. And we're gonna chat a little bit about both those things today. John, I know that near and dear to your heart is Zion Williamson, the number one overall pick in the NBA draft out of Duke for the New Orleans Pelicans. He was diagnosed with, what was it, a torn meniscus, and he's going to
yes.
be out for the first 6 to 8 weeks of the season. And that just really puts a dampener on what was expected to be a wild and woolly NBA season to begin with. What's your take?
Yeah, it's a crushing blow, and it's interesting to for me to be this upset about a guy that went to Duke. But
yeah.
Zion, an absolute superstar, you know, has taken the world by storm. Was so excited to see him play. I was out at the Summer League in Vegas for my brother's bachelor party over the summer, and I didn't get to see him play there either. The one game he played, and he hurt himself in that one, was the day before we went, of course, so I didn't get a chance to see him live, but naturally, of course. But I was so excited to see him play. And look, the NBA had the Pelicans and the Raptors to open things up, I believe, tonight. How funny is that, that they had Pelicans-Raptors, and there's no Kawhi in Toronto, there's no Zion playing. This game went from, you know, top of the line to a hot pile of garbage. And it's just so sad. But I was worried about this with Zion, Josh, because he reminds me a lot of Blake Griffin. Incredibly talented, but relies so much on that athleticism with a big body, you know, just the way he's built. Injuries are likely to happen. He had an issue at Duke as well. So
right.
I can't say I'm surprised, but I'm incredibly disappointed.
Yeah, Shoegate or Nike, was it a Nike sneaker? I think it was.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, that just exploded on the court that that one game that really kind of set him off for months at a time. So yeah, it's definitely not a great start for Zion, for sure. And yeah, frankly, the biggest concern that I have with that is twofold, really. One, you're right, the Pelicans and the Raptors, not exactly very, very attractive teams when it comes down to their superstars not being present, especially with Toronto. You know, they really thought that they were building a thing there with Kawhi, and he goes out to LA. And now, you know, you've got the Clippers and you've got the Lakers, absolutely kind of the headline franchises now, and really throughout most of NBA history, certainly for the Lakers anyway, and with Kawhi and building a team around him out there in LA. You know, we're getting a lot of emphasis on kind of the battle of LA and whether it's going to be a thing that's to be dealt with, or if it's just, I don't know. I feel like on our side of the country, it's more of a, all right, talk to me during the playoffs and we'll see what happens then, or talk to me when LeBron or Kawhi or somebody else like that kind of gets hurt.
Yeah, fair enough. Okay, Josh, I'm going to give you two choices.
Yeah.
For the NBA championship, you can either have the city of Los Angeles or the field. Who you got?
Field.
Interesting.
Yeah, without thinking twice.
Wow.
I mean,
okay.
Just because I feel like the Clippers are kind of a cursed franchise, and I feel like LeBron is getting up there in age to the point where he's not going to be able to necessarily carry a team anymore. We saw that a lot in the last couple of seasons. So I don't know who I'm picking out of the West outside of that, but, and frankly, I haven't given a whole lot of a look to it, but you know, I think that the field look at Houston. I mean, Houston has a lot of potential to really kind of come out on top as well. They've been building for the past couple of years now, and with Westbrook and Harden there. Harden's just always a force to be reckoned with. Of course, he's getting up there as well. So I don't know. Maybe I'll take Houston. So it's a tough call, though.
Yeah, fair enough. I actually disagree. I would take Los Angeles. I would be really surprised if either the Lakers or the Clippers don't win the whole thing. I agree that LeBron is certainly getting up there, but he has never had a teammate near as good as Anthony Davis.
Yeah, that's fair.
You know, Davis has been stuck playing for New Orleans, and, you know, before Zion, nobody cared about New Orleans. So many people haven't really seen just how good Anthony Davis is. He may be the best overall player in the league. He's certainly in the top five. And
I think that's reasonable.
Yeah, and what he's already done with LeBron in the preseason has been absolutely spectacular. And I love the way, and again, I don't like to give Rob Pelinka a whole lot of credit, but what they've done to build around those two, you know, keeping Kyle Kuzma, which I think was important. Now he is hurt,
huge,
but he will. Yeah, he's hurt right now, but he will be back in the fold. I love who they brought in, Avery Bradley, Danny Green, defensive guys that can shoot from the outside. Take a flyer on Dwight Howard to give you some space inside. It's disappointing that they lost DeMarcus Cousins, because I think that was a shrewd signing as well. But they really have a nice nucleus there. And then the Clippers managed to keep all of the players that they had basically from last year, except for Alexander, and they bring in Paul George, they bring in Kawhi Leonard, they've still got Montrezl Harrell and Patrick Beverley, and Doc Rivers is one of the best coaches in the league for sure. So I really think LA is going to be able to win the whole thing. I'd be really surprised if they didn't.
Yeah, you and I can both agree that the reign of the Warriors is pretty much yes. at its end.
Well, certainly for this year. I still think that they're going to be very competitive. If they can get Klay Thompson back for the playoffs, they have a shot to do something, but I have a feeling he's going to sit the whole year just to be smart. But even without him, with Draymond Green, D'Angelo Russell, Steph Curry.
The other one.
Yes, yeah, right. Seth Curry's pretty good, too, but he's not Steph Curry.
Right.
You know, they will still be a good team, and Steve Curry is the best coach in the league, not named Greg Popovich, but it's going to be hard without Clay, and, you know, Sean Livingston retired. They don't have Andre Iguodala anymore. So, you know, that is going to be interesting, to say the least.
Yeah, I think one of the things that always defined that particular franchise as it was on the come up and as Curry was coming into his own was the ability for Steve Kerr to put together a true team atmosphere. And I think it's just been a little bit awkward the past couple of years with Durant. And now that Durant is gone and has made his way to Brooklyn, that actually improves the locker room a little bit in Golden State.
I agree.
And we'll see you can't even say if they overcome, because it's almost just a return to normalcy.
Sure. And again, they've still got great players. Steph Curry's a top 10 player. Draymond yeah. Green is a top 20 player. D'Angelo Russell last year played like a top 25 player. So the team will still be good. And again, if they get Klay back for the playoffs, they've got a shot. But I just can't see the Warriors risking a re-injury for him when you can just bring everybody back next year. So we'll just have to see.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, it's way too easy, not way too easy, but it's way too early rather to, I guess, put in our predictions for an NBA championship. But I mean, obviously we've said our piece on the West. Do you think that Durant makes Brooklyn the favorite to come out of the East, or do you think that they've got quite a ways to go? Obviously Kyrie Irving there now too. Jordan, a big acquisition that it's center available also. So I don't know. Do you think that they've got what it takes, or are we still looking at Boston trying to redeem themselves after so many years?
Yeah, look, I am not as enamored with Brooklyn as other people are. It's not that I don't love Durant. He's a top five player in his own right, but I don't love Kyrie Irving. He's shown the flaws. He's also shown tremendous ability and has had great moments, but they've all been with LeBron.
Yeah.
Now Durant is really good. Durant could be a 1B to LeBron's 1A, but I'm not sure how well those two will mesh together. I don't even think we'll see Durant on the court this year, just because, again, like with Klay Thompson, you don't want to risk something there. To me, there's only really two options in the East for me, and it's Philadelphia and Milwaukee. I don't think Boston's got enough. Obviously, Toronto takes a massive step back. I think Miami yep. could be interesting with Jimmy Butler and some of the youngsters there. I'm not saying to win the championship.
Yeah, they've grown up.
They've got some pieces. But for me, it's either Milwaukee or Philadelphia. This is the 76ers' best shot, because next year Brooklyn obviously will have Durant. I think Boston could be better even in another year with some more draft picks. This is Philadelphia's year to get to the finals. This is their chance. They brought they obviously kept Tobias Harris. They brought Jason Richardson over from the Miami Heat in the trade that sent Jimmy Butler over there. So
right.
they've got Richardson now in tow with Harris, with Embiid. Ben Simmons hit a three in the preseason. It basically broke the internet. So this is their best shot this year. If they want to make the finals, got to get it done this season.
Yeah, no, I think I agree with you there. Philadelphia obviously has not really had its had its come up in quite some time, and they're would you say that they're due? I mean, I guess, but yeah, I mean, your take that it's their time because the way has essentially been paved for them. I guess it goes through Milwaukee. You know, does Giannis stay as dominant in the East as he has been? So,
yeah, I mean,
I suppose there's the chance.
Yeah, they lost Malcolm Brogdon to the Pacers. That is a big loss because he was really good off the bench, but they are still really good. And look, you know, I said Jason Richardson. Yeah, he won the dunk contest for the Warriors. I meant Josh Richardson. I'm losing my mind here. look, it's Jay Richardson. I was close. But look, Giannis is the reigning MVP. Well-deserved. Could win it 2 years in a row. I still think Milwaukee has as good a chance as anybody to make it to the finals in the East. Again, I would pick them or the 76ers. But without Malcolm Brogdon, that is a loss. So we'll see if the Bucks can make up for that.
Yep, fair enough. And I mean, at this point, seemingly every year, it's a foregone conclusion that whoever comes out of the West is favored to win the title there. And you know, we're just going to have to make it through some of the craziness early on to get to the real meat of the season. And it doesn't seem like the NBA season really starts until Christmas anyway. And by then, we'll have those 2 months have elapsed, where Zion and company will have a chance to recover and actually give us what we want.
Speaking Josh, to be honest with you, you're being too generous. The NBA season doesn't really start till like June. So
fair enough.
Let's forget the regular season. Let's just go straight to the playoffs.
It may as well be that. So I mean, I feel the same way for the NHL in a lot of different ways as well. But yeah, I don't know. I, for one, look forward to some of the early season moves and New Year's Day as well. You know, each league kind of has its holiday that it likes to grasp onto. For football, it's Thanksgiving. For the NBA, it's Christmas. For college football, it's New Year's Day. And that kind of a mess is yet to come. So really interesting fall and winter heading into the seasons for hockey and for basketball. And of course, football is well underway. We're going to take a quick break. Speaking of being well underway, speaking of giving the fans what they want, we'll take a quick break and we'll rejoin you after this word from Public House Media Network.
What's up, everybody? This is Christian Heimel, host of Press Row here on Public House Media. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media. Once you're done with this episode, I hope you'll come check out my show, Press Row, where we talk about the biggest issues in sports with the analysts, experts, and reporters who cover them. No nonsense, hard-hitting interviews on the sports topics you're talking about. A new show comes out every single Thursday. And don't forget to subscribe on iTunes so you never miss an episode of Press Row. Thanks again for checking out the following broadcast on Public House Media.
Right back here in the cheap seats, brought to you by Public House Media on a Tuesday. And it wouldn't be a Tuesday if I didn't plug Tuesday Night Quarterback with myself and Kayla Zenner on Facebook Live. Definitely make sure that you join us at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 Central, as we break down the week that was in the NFL and preview what's coming up in the upcoming week. That's repetitive, but yeah, it's what we've got. So we happen to have a little bit of a hiatus for last week, a little bit of an emergency on our side, but you guys don't really care about that. We certainly appreciate you tuning in and watching whenever you get a chance. We appreciate you on this side of things listening whenever you get a chance. Definitely rate us, like us, comment, share, favorite, whatever the most recent social media actions of the day are supposed to be. Please do that. Please follow the Cheap Seats by Public House Media on all your favorite podcast apps and on your social media platform of choice. John, we talked a lot about Zion Williamson and how his injury affects the outlook for the NBA season upcoming. And as the NBA season and the NHL season start, Major League Baseball's season is coming to an end. We've finally got the long-awaited World Series, Houston Astros, Washington Nationals, and John, I couldn't help but turn up the schadenfreude for simply the way that things developed to get Houston and Washington into baseball's final. And one of those most significantly for me, and I know that you mentioned earlier not feeling great about feeling bad for a guy from Duke. Everybody hates the New York Yankees.
That's true.
Everybody hates the New York Yankees who doesn't live outside of, I don't know, Manhattan, any of the other five boroughs probably. It doesn't really matter. Either that or you're a front runner, and I have not very much respect for you as a sports fan, but it is what it is. And it's just a matter of, hey, they win all the time, and I like to see the big behemoth clubs fall every once in a while. And it's hilarious because that stat came out. And this is the thing that I want to make a big deal out of. That stat came out that since the New York Yankees failed to beat the Houston Astros in the American League Championship Series, this is the first time that the New York Yankees have not made a World Series in a particular decade since about World War I. So in about 100 years. And it's just kind of silly to verbalize that. So all that really means is that they didn't make a World Series in the decades of the 2010s. That would have been a much more simple way to put things, but naturally all the sports media outlets had to make a big deal out of the 100 years since they've not had a decade where they've made a World Series. And it's silly and it's stupid, but I relish in it anyway.
Well, look, it's real simple, Josh. Who's the most hated team in Major League Baseball?
It's the Yankees.
Right. And who would you say is the most hated player in all of Major League Baseball?
Gosh, that's honestly kind of tough for me to say.
Well, I'm going to give you my answer.
Yeah.
It's Bryce Harper. And Bryce Harper and the Yankees are currently sitting home right now.
Yeah.
So that's all you need to know.
That's who I was leaning toward. And it's hilarious because, I mean, I don't think Harper had any better chance of going to a championship with Philadelphia than he did with Washington. And, you know, it's that addition by subtraction kind of thing, I suppose. It's this team is a whole lot less interesting without this player, but somehow the locker room sort of puts it together. We talked a lot about it in segment number one with what those NBA clubs have to do without their superstar. And, you know, that's what Washington, that's what Dave Martinez ended up doing. It's kind of astonishing that they just kind of plowed through St. Louis. But yeah, it's hilarious that those we expect to do great are, yeah, sitting at home.
And the fact that the Dodgers, again, fall
outspending
short,
everyone.
Right. And again, Clayton Kershaw. He's arguably the greatest regular season pitcher of all time, and he's absolute trash in the playoffs. It's crazy.
Yeah, or at least of this generation, I suppose.
Yes, for sure.
At least the past decade.
Yes.
Yeah, and it's funny. I mean, I almost feel bad for those guys because I do want to see hard work cashed in, and you know, that's what we saw with Washington in a lot of different ways. So,
yes,
but I still can't really bring myself to cheer for that team because as a Pittsburgher, as a guy who saw Gerrit Cole just kind of grump his way out of town and succeed in every possible way that everyone around here knew that he could and would and should. I mean, the baseball analyst in me saying, you know, good pitching beats good hitting every day of the week. I mean, that's absolutely what we saw with the Houston and New York series. And I'm hoping it carries over into the World Series as well. You know, I mean, obviously Houston has Justin Verlander as well. And it's amazing to say that Verlander isn't even really the ace there anymore. Of course, he's up in age. Cole has taken over that role. So, yeah, let's see what happens. But, yeah, I just think it's hilarious that the big spenders are out, and we've got these mid-market teams in an environment in baseball where that still makes a difference, succeeding at the highest level.
And look, Houston, if they win this one, they're on their way to a dynasty, and
that'll be three, right?
I think it's only two, but
I think it is two.
Right.
Their third appearance.
Right.
In
right.
recent memory.
Exactly, but they've been nothing short of amazing. And again, no Dodgers, no Yankees, no Red Sox, Mets nowhere to be found, Cubs struggling now, and they've lost their manager. So, you know, the mid-market teams continue to make a whole lot of noise.
Right. And that's what Bud Selig envisioned when he was commissioner
sure.
of baseball. And here we are. The Milwaukee dream has come true.
Indeed. Silly.
So yeah, I want to just go back, John, to the whole 100 years since there's been a decade without the New York Yankees in a World Series. What is something that it will be that you would rather not see happen in sports in another 100 years?
I would love to see the Patriots go 100 years without winning a Super Bowl.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's probably the easy pick. That's probably what I would have said also. I think I would like to go another 100 years without having to talk about salary caps and labor disputes and billionaires upon millionaires. It's one of those things that we talk about all the time. But once we realize that the product is the product, then that's something that I'd love to see finally achieve.
Yeah.
Peace. So I guess I'd like to go another 100 years without hearing about various levels of such and such a player being blackballed because of social injustices.
I'd love to go 100 years without hearing about Colin Kaepernick. That'd be nice.
Yeah, so there's some things that we could definitely do without. That's gonna bring us to the Facebook poll question for you, the listeners out there. We talked earlier about picking your NBA champion while it's still fresh. The World Series starts tonight on Tuesday. Let's hear it. What's your pick for the World Series champion? Does Houston get further on their way to that dynasty that John mentioned, or does Washington finally cap it? You know, John, I forgot to mention that these Washington Nationals, in not very distant memory, were the Montreal Expos.
True.
Do you think that fans of Montreal have any claim to a Washington title, assuming that Washington does win the title, if that's going to be your pick? Do you think Montreal should feel good about their franchise, which they lost, cashing in on a title, or are they just persona non grata?
All right, I'm going to answer your question with another question.
Yeah.
Should Seattle feel good if Oklahoma City ever wins an NBA championship?
They should feel good about drafting Durant.
Although Durant's not on Oklahoma City anymore.
That's true, but I feel like that's just kind of the way that the league works, the way that free agency works.
That's true. To me, the answer would be no. Major League Baseball took baseball from Montreal. I don't think they should feel good about the Nationals winning it. And to be honest with you, they're not going to win anyway, so it's not going to matter.
Yeah, I think I'm all in on Houston as well. 2004, the Expos left. So I mean, there's an entire generation at this point of people who don't even remember the Montreal Expos existing. Gosh, we're getting old.
Because yes, it seemed like just very
seemed like just 10 years ago to me, but you know, it's 15 years, so it is what it is. But yeah, I think Houston cashes in as well. So we've got your pick, you've got my pick. How many games, John?
I'm going the full seven. I think it's going to be a great series, tremendous pitching, but Houston pulls it out in seven.
Yeah, I'm going to go Houston in six, just because I think they are going to manage to snag one on the road and kind of make it a little bit scary. But they played that series against New York kind of by the seat of their pants as well, so it would not surprise me in the least if it goes seven. But yeah, I'm gonna go Houston in six. We want to hear from you. Chime in on your pick for World Series champion. We want to hear you chime in for a very early pick for an NBA champion. John, as we wrap up the show this Tuesday, kind of throwing it all over the different place, what did you learn this week?
I've learned that Zion needs to be put in a bubble. Let's do it now.
Yeah, you know, I could see that, and I even read an article, and I kind of threw up in my mouth a little bit reading this article. Basically, somebody just commented, Zion's fat. Like, Zion should worry about his frame. Zion should start to lose some weight. Like, it's so silly. I mean, he's a special player, but he is probably one of those guys that needs protected. I learned that there is great diversity in basketball, and that there is finally a chance for Midwesterners to cash in on what previously was East and West Coast glory in baseball, in basketball, and all over the place. Thanks to each and every one of you for joining us this time around. I hope you all had a great Back to the Future Day, and with that, we will see you in the future.